Let's do a small Q&A. What are you planning to do after your college applications are finished? Raise your hand if you'd like to go on a trip. Okay, then anyone would like to just eat and sleep all day long? Okay, thank you. Well, for me, my plan is to write a biography for my grandparents. And let me tell you why. Once I saw a traveling advertisement about Wujiang, which is a small ancient water town in Suzhou. My grandmother suddenly said to me, "You know what? That's my hometown. I used to live there before I came to Shanghai." Then she told me a long story about her childhood. And it was at that time I got to know that my grandmother was born in a big patriarchal family that owned silk business. It was in the 1930s. And later, her father moved entire family to Shanghai for business. In 1949, my great-grandfather transferred the ownership of his silk company to the government in response to the public economy at that time. And that's the end of the tale of old China. I was intrigued by my grandmother's story because through her life experience, I got a glimpse of the transformation of Chinese society from the 1930s to 1950s. Not from the descriptions on historical textbooks, but from an ordinary person's life. It was at that time I realized that history does not just belong to elites, emperors, politicians, or heroes. We, as normal, insignificant individuals, could also be the owner of history, because people are history. However, nowadays, there is something about history believed by the majority, yet doesn't appear to be absolutely correct. For the majority thought, history is just what appears on books and screens, presenting lives of significant figures that propel the shifts of human society. For example, Octavian established the Roman Empire. Shakespeare composed a tremendous amount of works that have enduring popularity. And Steve Jobs brought the metamorphosis of technology. Being a part of history seems to be a privilege for the majority, not just because there are no specific records dedicated to us, but also these events seem to be so unachievable for us as normal individuals, which ironically make us, the majority of society in terms of numbers, the minority in history recording, which in this case I like to call ourselves the historical minority. But for me, I believe that every action and every decision we made in our past and our present are not just footprints in our own lives, but also a significant contribution to our society's memories. Thus, my minority thought is history of individuals, of normal individuals, are also an indispensable part of history. And we, as normal individuals, should preserve and record our history together to prove our significance in enriching our society's memories in a fast-developing era. In my spare time, I work as a volunteer guide at Shanghai Jewish Refugee Museum, which is a museum about the life stories about the Jewish refugees who fled to Shanghai during World War II to avoid the persecution of Nazi. And unlike those traditional museums which focus on the general historical backgrounds, the Shanghai Jewish Refugee Museum is a collection of the life objects and stories of these individuals. For example, visas to Shanghai, steamer tickets, ID documents, and even engagement certificates. These are all tiny details from these persons' lives. Yet together, they depict a general image of how these individuals came to Shanghai, what they encountered during their journey, and how they survived in an unfamiliar Oriental city. Here, they are not treated as a collectivity with the title Jewish refugees. Neither are they considered as the minority of World War II's history or even world history. Instead, they are paid enough attention to and respect as individuals who experienced history and made contributions to it. Now, you may wonder, why should we pay all this attention to those historical minorities since they have no relation to us? Well, because I believe that a single event could have different impacts on and perceptions from different people. The Shanghai Jewish Refugee Museum is a good example for this. Once, I was invited to a documentary film's sharing ceremony about a German artist named David Louis Bloch, who fled to Shanghai in 1938 and married a Chinese woman here. In 1945, the young couple went to America and had two children there. What struck me the most about this documentary was that it was told from the perspective of their younger son, about his exploration of his father's entire life path. Now imagine this, father and son, two individuals, two generations, but are both the witnesses of a significant period of time in human history. How many of us nowadays will realize that our loved ones may be the recorder of history that could tell amazing stories that history books can never tell us? Thus here, I encourage you all to embrace history and the recording of history with love and gratitude. Because among the flow of human history, there are fragments made up of ours and our loved ones' lives. The second thing that struck me the most was Mr. Bloch's Chinese wife, Ms. Zheng Dixiu. She didn't leave much details to be talked about in the documentary film, and I know that she used to be a lady born in a wealthy family, but she has to work in a sweatshop factory when she came to America to support the living of her family. Imagine what kind of despair and pressure she must have faced as an individual who didn't understand any English living in a completely unfamiliar country. And not to mention, she only received misunderstandings from her sons. She led a silent life until she passed away. And at a ceremony, I asked Mr. Bloch about his memories about his Chinese mother, and he couldn't tell any details about his memories about her. And not to mention about his Chinese blood that made up half of his identity. There were thousands of women who shared similar experiences as Ms. Zheng. Together, as a significant part of immigration history, especially women immigrant history, they're always forgotten. And hence, they're also a type of historical minority caused by the negligence of people. At that moment, I sat quietly in that documentary sharing ceremony's room and realizing that as soon as their children passed away as well, their stories will never be remembered, and a huge part of human history will be lost. Such oblivion could be avoided as long as every one of us has the awareness that history is not just a privilege of elites or politicians. We as normal individuals could also be part of history. Dave Isay once provided a promising future in his TED Talk titled, "Everyone Around You Has a Story the World Needs to Hear." And now I'm going to adapt this into my own talk to put my minority thoughts into ideas. Suppose there is a national assignment requiring that all students in China taking history classes are going to interview an elder in their family. Then at that moment, the history of an entire generation will be recorded and preserved at that moment. If this continues to remain as a minority thought, think about how much we could lose as a collectivity. And we are moving ever faster towards our future and paying less and less attention to our back, where our memories and past are. And it is them that define who we are. Together as individuals, or teenagers, or children, or adults in a family, we could record and preserve our history together. It is not just our right, but also responsibility. Here, I encourage you all to interview an elder or any loved ones in your family, or even your own life history, because through the history recording of historical minorities, we could better understand what history is. And in the end, I would like to remind you of our beloved history teacher, Mr. Dai, who previously gave his TED Talk, his famous question about history learning, and what's the meaning of learning history? Well, here, I'm going to provide my own answer. To understand how oblivious and insignificant we are, and how valuable and important our life history as an individual are. Thank you.